morning, church family. So good to see you this morning. And we had a good time in our Sunday school hour. Hope you enjoyed your class and the Word of God that was taught to you. And we're looking forward to an awesome week this week. And this is the first of our revival services. And we certainly have been praying for God to revive our hearts, to do work in our hearts. And so that may spill over and reach a community and the lost for the sake of Jesus Christ. So we're glad you're here this morning. And just before we stand and sing, I want to read two very favorite scriptures of mine from the book of Romans. And the theme this morning you'll get with the songs is, because of the faithfulness of God, I'm so thankful He reached down and saved a wretch like me. Amen. How many are thankful you're saved this morning? You say amen? Amen. And I never want that should never get old. We should never get over that, and we should always be able to express our excitement about that. I love what the Bible says in Romans chapter 8 and verse 1, just dear verses to me. There is therefore now no condemnation, get this, to them which are in Christ. I'm thankful I'm in Christ, church. I'm thankful for that. Jesus, who walked not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Notice verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. I mean, thankful that when He saved you, He set us free from the power and penalty of sin. Amen? Let's all stand together. You know this song, Hymn 305, if you need your hymnal. He set me free. And let's think back to that day that He broke those bonds that had us bound, and let's rejoice in our salvation this morning.
Free.
Amen. You may be seated, and so thankful for that day that he did lift us out of sin and miry clay. He set us free and gave us the rock to stand upon. So glad I'm saved. So glad you're here this morning. Once again, we welcome you, and let's pray, and let's ask the Holy Spirit of God to speak to our hearts today, to minister to us, to use his word to penetrate our hearts and do a work that only he can do in our midst this morning. Brother James, would you mind standing and leading us in this opening prayer, please? Amen. It's so good to see some visitors with us today as well as our people. Thank you so kindly for coming and joining us today. Good to have some of our students back, and we're able to fellowship with them a little bit in the Sunday school hour. Thank you, young people, for being back in service with us, and good to have some first-time visitors with us today. And we welcome you here at Wildwood, and anything we can do to help you while you're here, please let us know. And we have a few announcements we're going to cover, and there's a connection card there in front of the pew. If this is your first time visiting or first time in a long time, would you so kindly take a couple of minutes and just fill out that card there, and provides us your information. On the back, there's also a section where you can list if you have any prayer requests, any special needs that you have, and you can note that there. And then if you'll just kindly tear the bottom portion of that card off and out at the Welcome Center in the lobby, we have a small gift for you. If you'll just give that to our receptionist after the service, and just a small gift, a way of saying thank you for coming and being in service with us today. We trust that the Spirit of God will minister to your heart while you're here with us. All right, for our folks, just a few reminders of some things coming up. Don't forget that this morning is just the first service of our revival meeting, and this year we're extending it all the way through Thursday night. And so Brother Austin will be back with us tonight, and then he'll conclude the meeting on Thursday night, and then Uncle Nate will be coming in Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Monday through Thursday services are at 7 o'clock, and so you make that note. And I've been saying now for weeks, and this applies to my life as well, we all are having to adjust things this upcoming week to make sure we can be here each and every service. And so you do that. You honor the Lord. You put him first. I promise you, as we do that, he'll honor us and bless us for our faithfulness. But let's do that, and let's be here. Invite somebody to come with you. Some of our folks have already done that and started this morning, and so we thank you for that. But invite folks to be in service with you each night of our revival. I know God wants to use these two men and to speak to our hearts, challenge us from his word. And so good to have your family here as well, and I'll let you introduce them as you come to preach here in just a little bit. But so thankful they could be with us in service this morning, and just looking forward to what God is going to do. And we still have some flyers left over, and it's not too late. Even though we're starting today, it's not too late. Please take those revival flyers on your way out. Okay, they're not just decor paper out there. We want you to take those and pass those out if you haven't already, and get those invitations out. Bring somebody to service with you. All right, teen missions trip. We're excited about this, and from talking to Brother Caleb, he feels like he's got at least a handful of teens going, and this is an awesome opportunity for our teens to be able to go and not only experience what it is like on a mission work, but also to be able to jump in and be a help and be a blessing to these missionaries. We know that ministry is always difficult, and sometimes these family units that are abroad trying to do work for God, they may not be surrounded by friends and families and fellow laborers. And so our young people have an awesome opportunity to go and be a blessing to them. And so young people, I'm excited for you. Remember, parents, the cost is covered, and so it's a blessing the church is able to do, and so we're looking forward to that. If you have any questions about that, you see Brother Caleb, and he can help you further, but I'd fully support you going and being a part of that, okay? We have a community outreach coming up on the 16th, an opportunity we have to love on families who will get out, and some some that would come to church on Resurrection Sunday weekend as one of the only few Sundays they get out and go to church. And so we'll be over at the Lucama Elementary School again. It was a great location for us in the past, a great turnout. We're right there in the community, so many homes right there around us. And so we'll be on the ball field again, looking forward to a great opportunity. They'll have the games for the kids once again and prizes, and then we'll be eating everyone that's out there. So be inviting. Do we have flyers out for that yet, brother? And if not, Brother Caleb's going to get some flyers out. We want to be passing those out. If we've ran out of what's out there, he'll get some more out there. But again, another opportunity for you to invite your neighbors, coworkers, anybody with kids, and even if they don't have kids, hey, we'll still feed them, amen? And they can come out and be a part of fellowship. I'm very pleased last year with our people that turned out, even if you didn't have kids, just to fellowship with those in our community and to be a blessing. That is so important. So thank you, church family, for how you helped with that, and trust that you'll consider to do that again this year as we'll be meeting out there. All right, then, ladies, you have your luncheon on the 30th of April this year at 12 p.m. just over in the Family Life Center. The details there are in the bulletin, so I'll direct your attention to that quickly to look at that and be familiar with all that is going on there. All right, last thing I'll announce is we've been doing this and it's gone over so well with our kids and families. So tomorrow night, we'll be bringing back the Revival Kids Club, okay, tomorrow night through Thursday night, and every night they'll be over in the Family Life Center, and after the preliminaries here, we'll dismiss them, and they go over there for a Bible lesson. We have rotating teachers that are going to help with that again this year. But remember, kids, you get to earn your Bible bucks, okay, Revival Bible bucks, and each night you get bucks for being here, for having your Bible. You get extra bucks if you bring a friend with you, and then the Bible memorization that'll be given. And so you can build up those Bible bucks, and on Thursday night, after the final lesson, you'll get a chance to go shopping, right, and cash in those Bible bucks and buy from the store that Brother Caleb will have available there on Thursday night. So we're excited about that. So you plan to be here. And if Mom and Dad wants to stay home one night, you tell them you got to come get your Bible bucks, all right? And to bring the whole family, invite your classmates, okay? You young people that are visiting with us today, you are more than welcome to come back. We'd love to see you throughout the course of the week. And many of you are on ball teams. Invite your ball team teammates and whatnot. Let's just have a good time in the Lord. And y'all be here. And it's going to be exciting. Of course, continue to pray that God will use Brother Austin and Uncle Nate as they come to share the Word of God with us. Okay, I believe that's all by way of announcement. And you can pick up a couple extra things there in your bulletin if you've not already done that. Okay, I'm so thankful for the men that help us on a rotating basis with our scripture reading. So you get your Bibles handy. Brother Linwood's going to come at this time and lead us in our scripture reading and in a word of prayer. And so let's tune in to how the Lord has guided him this morning.
Thank you, Brother Pastor. I tell you, there's not no better way to start the service this morning by singing that song, "He Set Me Free and He Lifted Me." As we were singing that this morning, I was thinking about that, went right along with it. I don't know what I do with a mic. I have never talked with a mic in my hand. And I get excited sometimes, and I use my hands, and I might throw it. I don't know. But I told the preacher, I never talk with a mic. Usually, I don't need one. But anyway, this morning, I'm going to try to contain myself and try to hurry it through this because I know we have a limited time here this morning. But I am so glad. In 1959, the Lord Jesus came down and he saved my wretched soul. And now I'm on my way to heaven. Lord, he lifted me. How about it, Brother Phil? Amen, amen, amen. If you got your Bibles, it's the King James Version, brother. Okay. He told me to make sure I had a King James Version. That's the only Bible that he is, as far as I know. But if you got your Bible, turn to chapter 37 in the book of Psalms. We're still in the book of Psalms. Most of the preachers that stand up here and talk to us on Sunday morning, they're out of Psalms. And I'm not a preacher, but I'm going to also come out of the book of Psalms. Chapter 37 is a psalm of instructions and wisdom. And David, I hadn't put this to my mind. I written that here, man. I don't know. David wrote this psalm in the latter years of his life, and we can understand and believe that because if you continue to read in chapter 37, verse 25, he says, "I have been young, but now am old. So that tells me that he's on up in age when he sat down and he wrote these scriptures here for us to read and to study and to find encouragement in today. It's important for you to know that this morning that David wrote this psalm from a point of personal experience. So many times you and I have a problem in our life or a situation in our life that we just quite can't seem to handle. And we might go to one of our dear brothers in Christ and friends and talk with them. And you know what the first thing might have come out of their mouth? I know how you feel. Well, no, you don't. If you haven't been through that, you don't know how I feel. I mean, I'm not being rude about this situation, but if you have not been through that type of situation or encountered that situation that I'm going through, you really don't know how I feel. It's just kind words to say. But here this morning, we have words of God written down by David that he knows how you and I feel. It's a personal thing to him. So you pick up in chapter 37 in verse number 4, and I'm not going to read the whole thing. I think it's 5 verses here I'm going to read this morning. Verse number 3 starts off, and David wrote this under the power and inspiration of God. And I believe, as we said, that he was an old man, probably had gray hair, he may have humped shoulders. But through the inspiration of God, I believe he took pen in hand, and he wrote these things down. And listen to the first word he wrote down in verse number 3. He says, trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. What greater advice can anyone give you and I today than to trust in the Lord? Trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the designs of thy heart, the desires of thy heart. What a great promise that is from God, that he's going to give you the desires of your heart. And it says in verse number 5, commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. And he shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. Listen to this. Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. We got 4 words there that David gave to us. He said, trust, delight, commit, and rest. That's a great recipe for you and I today to take a hold of and to carry in our hearts and our lives and to go by to help us through whatever situation we might be going through. Now, I'm not going to elaborate on all 4 or 5 of those verses this morning for the sake of time, but I'm going to pick up one verse here, and that's verse number 7, and it says, rest in the Lord. When I read that years ago, and I didn't quite understand, Lord, what do you mean? Or David, what do you mean when you say rest in the Lord? When I rest, I go home, I get back in my recliner, I throw my feet up, and I sit back, and I call that rest. But this is not what David is talking about here. He's talking about spiritual rest. And when he said, rest in the Lord, I studied this thing and pondered upon it many, many times before I ever really, the Holy Spirit ever really revealed to me what was really going on here. And I had to back up the chapter to verse number 5 when it said, commit thy way unto the Lord. In other words, my friend, what it means to you this morning, if you've got a problem, if you've got a trial that you're dealing with every day for days in and days out, and you find out you just can't handle it, the Bible says, commit it unto the Lord. Commit means to roll over. Roll over. So that means, you know, my God and your God has shoulders a lot bigger and a lot stronger than mine. He can handle anything up there on his shoulders that you dare to roll over and give unto him. And when he says give it to me, that means to give it to me and walk away and leave it alone. That's what the word rest means. It means when you roll that situation over onto me, then you just turn around and walk away and calmly leave it alone. Don't come to this altar and put it on that altar, then pick it up and carry it back with you. You're not leaving it with the Lord. He says, rest in the Lord and wait patiently on me. Well, we'll do that. And sometimes when we do that, if we don't get a satisfaction within a day or two, then you might begin to mumble and grumble and get a little bit upset. And I'll guarantee you, if you don't have success from that problem in a day or two, the devil is going to face you right face to face and tell you, I thought your God was going to take care of that for you. But he has not done a thing for you yet. Well, what you need to do right then is look him right square in the eye and say, devil, let me tell you. The Bible says, rest in the Lord and wait patiently on him. That's what I'm doing, devil. I'm waiting patiently on my God because I know that my God will see me through. David says that when I went through the fire, I found out that God, that same God that was on this side of the fire, walked with me through the fire, and he was on the other side of the fire. And that same God is the same God that's going to walk you through the fire today. Let me tell you this morning, my friend, for the sake of time, I'm going to close this down. If you have a problem today, if there's a situation in your life today that you don't seem like you can quite handle, then I ask you to bring it to this altar and then roll it over on God's shoulders. God will gladly take care of it for you. He'll see you through what any situation you might need and desire to go through. He will see you through, my friend. God will see you through. We just have to wait patiently on the Lord. He might not answer it today. He might not answer it tomorrow. He might not answer it next week or next month. But God will see you through if we wait patiently on the Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, as we stand before the throne of grace today, Lord, I'm so thankful that I serve a true and a righteous and a holy God, a God that loves me. And a God that's telling me at all times, if you have a situation in your life, my child, just roll it over on my shoulders, because my shoulders are big enough to carry it. And I promise you, God says that I'll see you through it all. And I pray for the dear people here this morning. I pray, Lord, this morning that we've come and we've started this revival here today. And I pray for the evangelist that's going to stand before us in a few minutes, the right to divide the word of truth. And I pray, God, you give him clarity of thought and good recall of the message you laid on his heart this morning to preach to us, a needed people. And Lord, as we continue through this revival this week, Lord, we pray that each of us will come with open hearts and an open mind and a receptive heart to the word that's going to be preached to us today. And Lord, I pray, Father, to be some that might come this week, dear God, that are lost and undone. Lord, this week might be a great time of salvation for that also. But yet, Lord, this revival is for God's people. And I pray, God, today that we, as your people, will come and, Lord, allow you to do that great work in our lives that you want us to have. And, Lord, I pray, Father, that you touch each and every service today. And, Lord, when we go through these services, Lord, that it won't be just a series of meetings, but it'll be a time that we have met with you and you have met with us. And, Lord, we'll be careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for all that is accomplished. For us, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Called to walk by faith, there'll always be the mountains and valleys in our way. But right here in this moment, may our strength be renewed as we recall what God has done and how we've seen him move. If there's anybody here, if there's anybody here who's hard to see, but be bold and courageous and follow where He leads. Greater is the one who's in us than he who is in the world. So child of God, remember the battle is the Lord's. If there's anybody here who's found Him faithful, anybody here who knows He's able,
say amen.
If there's anybody here who's seen His power, anybody here brought through the fire,
say amen.
Anybody here found joy in the midst of sorrow, peace in the storm, hope for tomorrow, and you've seen it time and time again, just say
amen.
Just stand and testify of the greatness of God in our lives. If there's anybody here,
so much to testify about, don't we? God sure is good. He's been so gracious, so merciful to us all. As choir ministered to us in that song, all of us could go in our minds time after time again, year after year again, and find ourselves at the faithfulness of Almighty God, who's never failed us. He's never left us alone. He's never let us down. And may I submit to you this morning, He never will. He's always faithful. Let's stand together. Hymn number 8, if you want to use your hymnals. Great is Thy faithfulness, O God my Father. And let's worship Him as we sing this song together. thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to each and every one of us. We have an opportunity to worship him with our tithes and offerings, being faithful, and to give back a portion of how he has so abundantly blessed each and every one of us. So I trust you. Be faithful to do that. We commend you for how you've been so faithful in doing that. And what an opportunity. I trust you can be, like the Word of God describes for us, be a joyful giver. And realizing everything we have comes from the hand of the Lord. And what a privilege it is to give back. So let's pray now and ask him to bless both the gift and the giver. Once we do, if we could start with sections 1 and 3 today. If you have an offering, if you'll please come. And then sections 2 and 4 can follow them as we give our tithes and offerings back to the Lord. Brother Roger, would you lead us in this prayer, please? Faithfulness, and we're going to have our men's trio come sing for us this time. And kids, we will be dismissing you to your class, but we'll do that right after the men sing for us and bless our heart and song. So men, you come at this time, and I believe you'll be blessed by the words and the truth of this song that they'll minister to us this morning.
About the stone that was rolled away. could have real life someday. It's about the cross. It's not all about the good things in this life I've done. It's not all about the treasures or the trophies that I've won. It's not about the righteousness that I find. Let's save me from my sin.
Amen, fellas. Aren't you thankful for that? It's all about the cross. And boy, if you don't know him today, if you've not experienced what he's done for you at the cross, you can receive him today. So thankful for that. And brother, you come because we're going to dismiss our kids. And I think we got Joab and Judah and Gloriana or Anna and with you today. And so, kids, we'll go ahead and dismiss you at a junior and children's church. And we're so blessed and honored to have you in the first part of our service. And you do a wonderful job. I'm excited about what God is doing with our young people, and certainly pray for them. Good to have Brother Austin with us, and he's serving the Lord in a local church and at our Bible college as well. And Brother, you come at this time. Glad your family could be with you. Your wife, Rachel, you come and minister to our hearts what God's given you.
Thank you, brother. I'm glad he actually got up here and introduced me and said, kids, you can be dismissed, because it would have been real discouraging to get up here and about 25% of the congregation just get up and walk out as you get. I'm glad my kids can go and participate in Children's Church. It is good to have them with us today. We were here about a year ago. My wife's my timepiece, should be my mouthpiece. We were here about a year ago. Brother Jonathan was sick, and so he had me to come over and fill in. And so I got to meet many of you at that particular time. And it's good to be back with you for this special service. But it is good to have my wife, Rachel. And as Brother Jonathan, your pastor said, my three children, Joab, which he is 12, almost have a teenager in the house, so be praying for me over the course of the next few months. My daughter and Gloriana and my youngest son, Judah. And so someone asked me a little while ago, I think it was Brother Caleb, he said, where's Judah? I said, listen very carefully, and when you hear something break, that's where he's at. All right? So it's good to have him. I don't know where to start this morning. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm sort of like a squirrel in Planner's peanut factory right now. What do we say about revival? Now, I'm going to make an assumption here this morning. And that assumption goes like this. I assume, and you guys know the danger here, but I assume that your pastor has shared with you something about what revival is and is not in the last few weeks. Somebody say amen. Raise your hand if that happened. All right, good. How many of you know what it is? All right, good. So I'm safe on that assumption. And I'm going to assume that he has clearly said we can have revival. We meet the qualifications that God has given us in his word. It is possible. I'm assuming he has said God wants us to be revived. Would you agree? But sometimes revival, and I appreciate the music, by the way, it has been outstanding. And why in the world your pastor of all the people in the world would have called to invite me, it is the grace of only God knows that. And I'm just humbled by the opportunity that your pastor has extended to me to be here this morning and tonight. So thank you and thanks be to God. But sometimes revival is not about saying amen. Amen just means let it be. The Old Testament, the Hebrew word is emet. Let it be. It is true. And so sometimes revival is about affirming what we believe, right? You believe in the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ as the only means for salvation. Say amen. You believe the local church has an importance. Say amen. But sometimes revival is about saying, oh me. And so this morning, I know you have visitors here. I want to be careful. Because I shared in Sunday school this morning, we took prayer requests, I shared this. Would you please pray for me with this message? And here's the reason. Before it got to you, God had to work it through me. And so my life has been miserable for 2 weeks. I don't mean that in the wrong way. I simply mean as I have read this passage and gone through this passage, what you will know, it's worked me over. And I haven't been able to say, amen, God, I have it. What I've been able to say is, oh, Lord, help me. Help me. So I want you to turn with me to James chapter 4. And we'll be there in just a few moments. I love the song that you just sung. It's a great segue into our message this morning. It's about the cross. The cross is that instrument in which God used, and it was his plan from the beginning to have his son crucified, having buried, to rise again, and to be visibly seen so that you and I, by faith and trust in that, would have eternal life. There's no other way. There's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we can be saved, Acts says. But the cross and the message of Jesus is not just about salvation. It's about living. God didn't save you to take you to heaven. He saved you to live. He saved you to live in this, what we call, world. Now, I'm going to mention a few things here, so just hold on. I submit to you that the greatest challenge that the Christian will have in this life, the rest of their life, is dealing with the things that are in this world, the flesh, and the devil. I don't need the devil to sin. Austin does a good job by himself. My flesh is that wicked. I'm like the Apostle Paul. The things I want to do, I don't do. And the things I don't want to do, that's what I find myself doing. Anybody else struggle? Just be real. It's revival. I would submit to you that worldliness will be the most difficult thing of life that you will encounter as a Christian. Because now you got that spiritual man residing in you. And now you're torn between the world, and you're torn between good and evil and godliness and wickedness. And inside of you, you're wanting to do the right thing, but you can't. And yet you don't want to do the right thing, and you do. I'm telling you, it's going to be a struggle the rest of your life. And the power of Jesus Christ at the cross is the same power you're going to have to rest in as you live. Listen, I don't just need Jesus, and I'm not just saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Austin Clark's got to live by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. I can't have the correct kind of marriage without Jesus. I can't love my kids without Jesus. I can't function in life without Christ. So it's no, I got my card, I'm on my way to heaven, and now I got to figure the rest of this out. The same power that saved you is the same power that needs to go with you in salvation, sanctification. Do you know what worldliness is at heart? I'm going to skip over a lot because I got a lot to get through today. What time restaurants around here get real busy? Huh? In Wilson. We actually drove around because we were a little bit early, you know, and I pulled up in here. It was actually about 9:10, and there was a white Honda sitting over there, SUV. I don't know whose that was. And I rolled by, and I'm like, man, I ain't going to be the second person at church this morning. So we rode on down Wilson. And we just stayed on the same road, brother, because if I got off, I don't know how I'd get back. But I just stayed on the same road, and we went into the most glorious place of all, the Golden Arches. I believe that'll be there to get the pearly gates, you know. But nevertheless, we stopped, and I don't know where every place is to eat in Wilson. I'm just not sure. When does it get busy? 12 o'clock? Okay, well, it's going to be real busy by the time y'all get there, okay? All right, because we might. Worldliness at heart is nothing more than idolatry. It's exchanging the truth of God for a lie. It's loving this creation. It's loving our pleasure more than loving God, Romans 1. When God created the world, after he was finished, he looked at it, he said, everything's what? It's good. So it's not when we say the world is evil, the trees outside are evil, or the whatever's going on, the air is evil. That has nothing to do with it. God created it good. Sin resides in the heart, Matthew chapter 15. And when the Bible uses the word world, oftentimes, more often than not, the word cosmos is not referring to the size of the globe, it's referring to the fallenness of the people that reside in it. That's why the Bible says this: the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life are not of the Father, but they're of the world. The Bible then would even say, love not the, neither the, if any man love the world, the love of the Father, it's not in him. This is the actual verb, the noun form that is utilized here for us in John 3, that beloved passage. For God so loved the what? Now, it's not talking about a population size. That word is whosoever. Amen. Let's just make that sure. But God so loved this fallen world with iniquity that he gave his own son. That's how much he loved it. Rebellion. Now, let me ask you this. I'm getting to the message, I promise. Does that mean that you and I are unable to enjoy the things of this world? Ecclesiastes says this: and also every man should eat, drink, and enjoy the good of all of his labor, because it's the gift of God. Amen? Christians are not conformed to the image of the world. We don't fall into its mindset. We don't adopt its practices. I am absolutely astounded if I were to sit up here and tell you, as I talk with college students and I ask them, what do you think about this topic and that topic? They do not filter life through the Bible. They filter life through their own thoughts. You know what that'll lead to? Conformity of the world. I am not to be conformed to this world. I am to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, Romans chapter 8. Now, what does that mean? It means I don't separate myself, listen carefully. I don't hide away in my monastery. I don't only just accumulate my little self with my little holy hut. Guess what? The world is my mission field. The world is actually where I live. It's where I work. It's where I reach lost people. The world is actually where I can demonstrate to the lost the actual grace of God. As a Christian, that's what it means when it says you're in it, but not of it. I have adopted a new mindset. Why? Because Austin is great? Because Austin has it all figured out? No, because the Spirit of God now resides in me. See, this life and your life too, guess what you are? If you're a believer in Jesus, you're just a pilgrim passing through. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm longing for a heavenly city. I'm longing for a place when I will be released from the bondage of this iniquity and live for his glory forever. That's what I'm longing for. Worldliness is the infection of sin. And we all struggle. Now, James 4. In many of your Bibles, if you have sectional headings, James 4 will begin a little bit like this: warnings against worldliness. And what James will do is provide three separate sections in this particular chapter on what worldliness is, how it's combated, and the perspective that we ought to have. Don't worry, I'm not going to deal with it all. I'm only going to deal with one, but I need to get there. Listen as James describes what it's like living in this fallen world. Let's begin in verse 1. Whence comes wars and fightings from among you? Come they not hence from your own lust, even war against your own members? You lust, ye have not. You kill, you desire to have, you cannot obtain. You fight in war, but yet ye have not, because ye ask not. And yet ye ask and you receive not, because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your own lust. Listen to these words. You adulterers and adulteresses, don't you know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Listen to me carefully. He says, don't you know that when you're viewing life and you're living life according to the principles of a fallen world, that you are committing adultery on God? This isn't referring to sexual sin. This is referring to viewing life through the filter of worldliness. And he says, you are now an adulterer before God. Strong? And he said, whosoever then will be a friend of the world is a what? Now, this is what James says about where we live. This is where you and I live. This is what I'm struggling with in life. I can't get along with one another because the lust of my fallen nature, I would rather kill someone in order to obtain what I can't have. Have you ever seen a selfish child? You ever seen a baby that cries? Oftentimes it's not because they want anything, it's because they want it. They don't need it, they want it, right? That's why Vody Bachman once said, that little baby that we think is so cute and so small, that's a viper in a diaper. He said, he went on to say this, you know why God made them so small? So they wouldn't kill you. Listen, we don't have what's best for us. We don't even desire and ask of God what is best for us because we want to consume it on our own lust. Listen, that's how sinful your flesh is, and listen, mine too. One of the greatest dangers to us as Americans is the lie that's been sold called the American dream. What is it? What is the American dream? Come here. Now listen to me carefully. I'm not against freedom. I'm glad we got it. But God isn't bound to my freedoms. There's millions of Christians all over this world. They don't have any of the freedoms that we're enjoying right now and are praising and worshiping God because God's not bound to my freedom. But I'm not against it. I'm grateful for it, right? However, listen to me carefully. What's the lie that's been sold about the American dream? Won't you go off and you get you a good job, get you a fat retirement account, you can do what you want, spend it how you want, live how you want. Oh, and I know we went over this, but man, you can marry whoever you want. And boy, that's even changed today dramatically, hasn't it? You can identify as to whatever you are. By the way, that is proof that Romans 1, when it says they gave them up over to, that they would have a seared conscience, that now the conscience can't even work correctly. That's how sinful we are. You say, man, why are you so passionate about this? Because this is where I live. This is what I'm dealing with. After explaining that human condition, he then gives us the antidote. Now watch this. I love verse 6. But he, who's that he, God, he gives more grace, whereof he saith, God resisteth the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So let me give you that. If he resists the proud, the opposite must be true. That means he actually stands with the humble. That makes sense? Now watch this. He says, then submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, he'll flee from you, draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to you, cleanse your hands, you sinners, purify your hearts, you double-minded, be afflicted, mourn, weep, so your laughter be turned into mourning. Grace and humility are the antidotes to worldliness. You have to realize, and so did I was totally, absolutely dependent upon God for everything I have. If I'm going to get to God, it was because of his redeeming power. If I'm going to get to God and live for God, it's going to be because of his grace. What did it require of me? Matthew chapter 5, blessed are the poor in spirit. Humility. I had to come before God, listen to me, naked, open, with nothing in my hands, saying, God, without you, I have to trust in your Son because I don't have anything worth accepting. My righteousness in the sight of God is filthy rags. That's why I said I'm not only saved by grace alone through faith alone, I have to live by grace alone through faith alone. I need him for every aspect of life. I don't come in my righteousness. I don't come in my religious observances. I come humbly before God to realize that apart from him, in salvation, in life, in marriage, in child rearing, whatever the case may be, without him, I am damned. Now, you say, wow, what does that have to do with anything that you're going to talk about this morning? On the basis of this passage, James will give us now the perspective that we ought to live by, knowing how devastating worldliness is, knowing what the antidote is. He says, and I'm telling you now, here's the perspective of how to live life. I want to preach to you this morning, for the time that I have, on this subject, life from the perspective of eternity. Our text being taken from chapter 4, verse 13 to 17. But before we get into those, would you pray and say, God, if there's any worldliness in me, would you remove it? God, if I'm not a Christian, would you draw me to yourself? Would you beg yourself now to say, God, if you speak to me through your word, I will respond. And if we'll do that, good chance we can leave here saying, we met with God. We had revival. Father in heaven, there's absolutely nothing, Lord, that I can say that's going to change anything. But Lord, if I preach your word, I have been promised that it will not return void. It will accomplish the very facts and the very things that needs to happen in the life of your people and in the life even maybe of someone here that is here on this divine appointed day. When they could have been anywhere else, you had them here for this day to hear this message. And God, I just pray that you would minister to our hearts. God, I pray, Lord, you do even just a portion of what you've been doing in my own life. Make us more like Jesus, we pray. In the name of our Savior. And God's people said, if you wanted to summarize the book of James, you could summarize the entire book in two words. Faith works. Faith works. Not to be just a hearer of the word, but to be a doer of the word. And the book of James is all about what faith looks like outside in the real world. I could take you through a bunch, but in James chapter 1, verse 27, I believe, he'll go on to say something along these lines. True and pure and undefiled religion is this: those that takes care of the fatherless, the orphans and widows. See, we've got in our mind that it's all about what I believe. Sometimes true and undefiled religion isn't just about what you believe, it's how you behave. William Hendrickson was once asked, what's more important, what I believe or how I behave? And he said, well, when you're at 30,000 feet, what's more important, the right wing or the left wing of the airplane? Both. And I want to give you from James chapter 4, 13 to 17, perspective, life's perspective from the perspective of eternity. Three simple thoughts this morning. You ready? Write them down if you take notes. Life is short. Let's read verse 13 now. Go to now, you or ye that say today or tomorrow, we'll go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get name. Verse 14, whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It's a vapor. It appears for a little time and then it what? Vanisheth away. When he says go to now, ye that say, you could say it in this way in our modern vernacular. You that are getting ready to say this, you better pay attention. Listen to me carefully. You that say you're going to go into a city, you're going to set up shop, and for a year you're going to have a good customer base, and you're going to make money, and you're going to get good returns, and You're going to do this and you're going to that. You better pay attention to what I'm getting ready to say. You know why? Because you don't even know what's going to happen tomorrow, much less a year from now. Life is short. He says it's like a vapor. You could put it a couple ways. I used to play a lot of basketball and a lot of football. Built for football, loved, anyway. Built for football, liked basketball. Man, we'd be out there in them cold Virginia mountain mornings. I mean, I'd have sweat just pouring off of me. And I'm talking about, I have been so cold by the time that I've walked to the bus, it's been so cold where I was, I had hair gel in. And when I got to the bus, my head was frozen, literally. That's how cold it got where I lived. And man, we'd be out there in them cold mornings just sweating and playing football. And then we'd stop and the steam is coming off of us. It gets real cold when you stop moving. But I'd watch it. It'd go up a few inches, disappear. We had ponds all around where I lived. Nice cool morning when the dew is, especially in the fall, it was gorgeous. You see the dew, and you see the fog rising off the pond, and it rises a couple feet, and then it's gone. Sun come out, fog's gone. You realize that's what James says. Listen, if you're going to combat this idea of worldliness, of living in this world, you need to understand something. Life is short. You better take inventory, he says, of just how long you've got left here on this earth. Now, time does not permit me to tell you all these stories, but I'm going to give you a couple. My friend, Thurston Carpenter, 18 years old, 5.5 months after we graduated school, he's beat a boy up bad in December. That boy was actually in my vehicle just the week before. His name was Brian Banks. Thurston actually walks away. Brian Banks gets up, pulls a knife out, stabs him from the back through the heart, kills Thurston, 18 years old, just a couple of weeks before Christmas. My friend, Tony Smith, childhood friend, had cystic fibrosis, wasn't supposed to live to be a teenager. Got saved. I mean got saved. Surrendered to call to preach, went to Gateway Christian College in Virginia Beach for a year to study for ministry, got sick, went home, didn't make it back to sophomore year. I preached his funeral. Wait a minute, God, you called a man to preach? You called him in to serve you the rest of your life and you took his life? My cousin Mike, mid-20s, on his way home from a Christmas party, under the influence of alcohol, hit a tree, died graveyard dead. When we mean graveyard dead, what we mean, everybody in the graveyard dead, but we mean instantly. Left behind my first cousin, Nikki, and two little girls. My dad, 53 years old, 2019, I called him on Father's Day. Said, Dad, happy Father's Day. And my dad said, Son, I've got 6 months to live. Lasted two. Carlton Poland, treasurer in our church at Faithful Baptist Church in Rockingham, most godly man I've ever met. Wouldn't even use a computer. Did all of our church documentation and finances on a typewriter. I mean a typewriter. You know what I'm talking about? Like, I'm talking about that kind of typewriter. He was caring for his wife who was struggling with dementia. He was sick. But he didn't want to be away from his wife. When he finally was able to go get checked out, stage 4 pancreatic cancer. Lasted 2 months. Job chapter 9 says that my days are swifter than a post. They flee away. They see no good. They're passed away as swift ships. The eagle that hasten its prey. Psalm chapter 90. Thou carriest them, that's mankind, away. They're as the morning grass, it flourishes, it grows up, and in the evening it's cut down and it withereth. He said, that's how long life is. It's almost as if it grows up in the morning time and it's doing real well, and then by the evening time it's done withered and you cut it away. Psalm chapter 90 is also the same chapter that of Moses, by the way. Moses writing that psalm, who says, our days are 70. And if by strength we get 80, that's 80. He says, but it doesn't matter. He goes, because then it's soon cut off and we fly away. So, the allotted time, and it's just proverbial. How many of y'all know someone that didn't get 70 years? Raise your hand. How many of you know someone that got a little bit more? Some of y'all might have been graced by that benefactor right there. But if you get the allotted time, 70 years, and some, they get 80. I thought about that. Brother, this hit me the other day, Pastor. 70 years, 840 months. 840 months if you get 70. Not even 1K. 840 months is 70 years. I'll be 37. Everything seems like 2 months in just a couple of months. It means I've spent 432 of them. If God gives me 70, I got 408 left. I'm halfway through mine. Now, some of you in here are a little bit older. Let me ask you, these months move quick, don't they? That's why George Bernard Shaw once said, the statistics of death are impressive. One out of every one dies. See, in my flesh, I think, worldly perspective, put the Bible aside. In my flesh, I think, this is what Austin's going to do. You know, I'm August the 12th. Someone asked me a little bit ago, Austin, are you finished your doctorate yet? I said, yeah, I'll be done August the 12th. And I'm like, ooh, wait a minute, that goes just against my message. I don't know if Austin's going to make it to March the 28th, much less August the 12th. See, that's viewing life through the perspective of my flesh. I got to view my life through the perspective of eternity. And what the Bible says is I'm not guaranteed tomorrow. Now, if the Bible's not against planning, is it? The Bible says in Romans to be diligent. Jesus says, who's going to go to war and not prepare? Who's going to build a tower and not calculate the cost? Go to the ant, thou sluggard. It's not against planning. It's against planning without God. See, I always think, Austin, you got this time to do this, and you'll be able to do this, and you'll be able to see your kids get to this point in life. And, you know, I don't know if I will. So you know what helps me combat the tendency to give in to worldly pleasure? Lord, I just don't know how much longer I got left here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to eat and drink, and I'm going to do all to the glory of God. Because I just don't know how much time I got left. Now, I'm going to move quickly. Years ago, if you were an Eastern emperor in Constantinople, on the day that you were elevated to the emperor status, the royal masons brought two slabs of marble before you. Two different slabs of marble. And on the day that the emperor was crowned, they had to choose their tombstone. You know why? This is what the ancients said. It is good to remember your death in the day of your exaltation. Simply put, life here does not last forever. So, knowing the brevity of life, it should point me to kingdom advancement. We've got parents, and man, you would not believe some of the stories from some kids out of state that we have at Southeastern College who decided at a service, they got on an altar and said, Lord, I want to serve you with my life. I want my life to matter for gospel ministry. And their parents are behind the scenes fighting them all the way. You need to go somewhere, brother, where you can make some money, you can make a difference, and you can give to the church. You know what that is? That's viewing life through the temporal. I don't care what you do. I want you to do what God wants you to do. And live life through the understanding that it doesn't last forever. Number two, life is short. Secondly, get this, God is sovereign. Verse 15, watch this. What you ought to say is this. If the Lord will. If you like to mark in your Bible, would you do that? If the Lord will, we shall live and do this or do that. In other words, don't talk like you're the captain of your fate. What you ought to say is, if the Lord will. Brother Jonathan, I was going to show him a message. Brother Jonathan sent me a message here a couple weeks ago. And he said, hey, you know, he's kind, extending this invitation. You know, he got, all, how many of y'all, he sent a text, he got praying hands next to it all the time. Huh? He got praying hands everywhere, you know, and lifting his hands up in the air and all that good stuff. I love it. And he's got praying hands, lifted hands, praying hands, smiley faces, all that good stuff in there. And he says, listen, well, I want you to come preach revival. And I said, oh, let me check, as a good Free Will Baptist, let me check my schedule. You know what that's code for? Let me go ask my wife. So I said, let me check the schedule, because I do children's church, oversee children's church at Shady Grove. And I got back with it. I said, yeah, man, I said, I'll be there. Boy, I started planning. And I was sitting in my office one day, and I'm reading a text message, and I'm, Austin, you don't know if you're actually even going to be there. What I should have said is, I gladly will accept. And by the grace of God, I'll be there, brother. You mark it down. Unless the Lord prohibits me, I'll be there. See, that's the way I need to view life. If the Lord wills. It's almost as if when someone asks you a question, you go to them and you say, let me talk to my Jesus about that. Let me check with my Lord. Let me make sure it's okay with my Heavenly Father. I tell the students in systematic theology that there are certain questions that we just can't ask what if on. We just deal with what is. And that's the one principle that I have dealt with. Some people say, well, what would have happened if Adam and Eve wouldn't have sinned? I don't deal in what if, I deal in what is. They did sin, and therefore now this is what we live with. But the second principle, if I could give to any student, it's not only we don't deal in what if, we deal in what is. Is the second principle of life for me as a professor is this. God is sovereign. I am not. Now I'm going to say something. And you do with this what you want. God's sovereign in the boardroom. God's sovereign in the bedroom. God's sovereign in the rising of nations. God's sovereign when they fall. God's sovereign in my marriage. God's sovereign in the life of how I as a parent am over my children. God is just sovereign. He's sovereign at this church. He's sovereign in your pastor's life and in your deacon's life. God is just sovereign. Notice I didn't say we need to live with the perspective God will be sovereign. No, God is, whether you like it or not. And hey, by the way, whether I like it or not. See, according to this text, I need to live with this idea. Lord, whatever you will. Because verse 16 says this, but now, that's actually referring to how they're living, but now ye rejoice in your boasting, and such rejoicing is evil. To live any other way than, Lord, what do you want, is actually evil as a child of God. This is the way the Apostle Paul approached life. Did you know that? Listen to what he said in 1 Corinthians 4. He says, I'm going to come to you if the Lord wills. Romans or 1 Corinthians 16, he says, I'm going to remain with you if the Lord will permit it. In Romans chapter 1, he says, at last, by the will of God, I was able to come to you. It's almost as if, like the Apostle Paul, James is calling for us to submit everything. Hey, where am I going to go to school? What am I going to do with my life? Where am I going to get married? Who am I going to marry? Am I going to have children? How am I going to spend my day? What am I going to do in the church? What in the world am I going to do with life? I'll do this if the Lord wills. The old Puritans, we get on them for a lot of things. Many of us would be sinners in their eyes because we don't have black, white shirts and black ties on, so we would be seen as flashy and sinful. So yeah, there's some self-righteousness, you might say, there, or Phariseeism there, I guess. But one of the things I appreciate about the Puritans is they'd write a letter to their congregation, they'd write a discourse, or they'd write a letter to other ministers, and at the bottom of it, and you can read Jonathan Edwards, you can read John Owens, you can read Richard Baxter, you can read all the old Puritans, and behind their name, they had these really small letters that I just really never recognized. And so it'd be like, you know, John Owens, D.V. What was that? It's a Latin phrase, Deo Volente. God willing. Here's my plans, God willing. Everything was cast into the will of God. Listen to me. Everything I do, everything I accomplish, everything I attain, it's the sovereign hand of God. This is not fatalistic, by the way. I'm not sitting back saying, well, I don't have any say-so in it, so I'll just let whatever happens, happens. No, James just gave us a whole bunch of commands to obey in the Scripture. It's active. This isn't passive. But it's the recognition that whatever I attain, whatever my accomplishment, whatever my service is in the body of Christ, time out. This is totally free, by the way. Every single person that's been regenerated by the Spirit of God, God gives a gift to use for the furtherance of His kingdom and in the building of the local church. You say, I don't know what it is. Figure it out. It's just you got something you can do. We had a lady in our church that was in a wheelchair for 50 years. She couldn't do anything, brother. See, there's a difference between making an excuse and having an excuse. You understand that difference, right? She couldn't do anything, but she could do one thing, and brother, could she do it well. You know what it was? Free Will Baptist, you want to take a guess what it involved? It involved food. But not just any kind of food, sweet kind of food, baking cakes. And that lady had no income whatsoever. Her son did good and looked after her. She probably is getting ready to pass away right now. But she'd bake them cakes and she'd sell them cakes for $30. And you know what she did with that money? She gave it to missions. So don't talk about what you can't do. Figure out what you can. And do it for the will of God. God willing, Lord willing, life is short. God's sovereign. Sin is serious. Look at verse 17. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him that's evil. This verse is taking into account God when we make decisions in our life about being conscious about the seriousness of sin. Now, that phrase there, he that knoweth to do good, could correctly be, if you know the right thing, do it. Otherwise, it's sin. Now, here's the thing. I struggled with this because I'm like, well, we all know that. Don't we all know what sin is? I mean, God says don't lie, you don't what? If God says you don't steal, you don't. God says you don't covet, you don't what? So I think in my mind, okay, the whole idea here is I'm going to stay away from sin. But that's not what he says. He says he that knoweth to do good. So what is this all about? This is actually what we refer to as sin of omission. Now, what is the difference here? Well, sin of omission, sin of commission. Sin of commission is when I commit something and I violate a command of Scripture. Sin of omission is when maybe the Spirit is prodding me and I don't do what I'm supposed to. So let me just clarify this for you a little bit. Earlier in the letter of James, he mentions showing favoritism. He says, man and man walk in, got a nice fancy old gold chain on, you know. He looked like Flavor Flav up in here with that big clock. And he walk, y'all, some of y'all will be like, I don't even know who Flavor Flav is. And some of y'all be like, I can't believe he just said that from the pulpit at Wildwood. But he walk up here and he sit there and we show favoritism to him because, oh, he's well-to-do. And then he says, but true and undefiled religion, you better take care of the fatherless. Don't worry about that man. He's all right. You worry about those who can't take care of themselves. Now, Jesus says something similar to this. He says that in the day of his return, he's going to separate goats and sheep on the right hand, on the left hand. On the left hand, he's going to put these people that said, well, Lord, we didn't know who to feed. We didn't know who to give water to. We didn't know that we needed to go visit them in prison. And he's going to say, as you've done it to the least of these, you've done it to me. But because you didn't, you'll be cast into everlasting fire. Because you didn't care for the needy, you're just as guilty as the fornicator and the idolater. One is sin of commission. See, the danger is, oh, I'm going to just keep a whole bunch of the stuff I'm not supposed to do, but then there'll be some things that I'm supposed to that I don't. And James says, I want you to know that's just as serious. So this is what ate me up, brother. How many people did I pass by this week? God had me stand next to him right at the gas station. Say hello. Say, hey, man, talk about gas prices. You know, everybody, if you're at the gas station today, you're like, how are you doing? You know, that's a bad question to ask, by the way, right now, especially if you have to run anything other than load test. But anyway, how many people did I come in contact with that God actually, get this, I believe in the sovereignty of God to such a degree that if I'm at the gas station and there's a young man that I know for a fact he's lost and he's strung out on meth, I'm supposed to talk to him because that's the people God's put in my path. And how many of them? Man, I don't need to talk to him. Or how many people, Christians, probably did you pass by this week or did you see and noticeably discouraged on their face? And I don't have time for that. Listen to me, I understand that my justification before God is tied directly to my faith in Jesus Christ alone. I understand that. But James is calling us. You better beware. Not just about keeping a list of what you're not supposed to do, but I want to know, what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? How are you talking to those people that you just pass by? Do you pray for the body of Christ? Do you lift up one another? Willfully disobeying God's commands, you know, lust and gossip and coveting, it's all active, but James is referring to when the Holy Spirit prods you. Listen to me, sin is not just about what's committed. Sin is also about what we omit. Now, sin is the transgression, the lack of conformity to the law. And this is what James is saying. You are just as guilty and I'm just as guilty as the fornicator and the homosexual. That we often, we say we don't categorize sin. Baloney. That's the Hebrew word for moron. Yeah, we do. I'm glad I don't do that. We're like that old Pharisee there. I'm glad I don't do that. I'm glad I don't do this. But yet we'll walk by people. We'll never proclaim the gospel. Husbands, do you love your wife as Christ actually loved the church? Do you know how he did that? Do you raise your kids and nurture the admonition of the Lord? Are you active in cultivating spirituality with your grandkids, with your kids? Or is it just, well, we'll go to church on Wednesday night and we'll let them take care of it? Or, you know, we'll do our little devotions. But, I mean, I'm talking about cultivating a life of spirituality. See, it's not just about what we commit, it's about what we omit. I'm going to say this and I'm getting done. Someone, why is this all important? Why is the seriousness of all important? Someone who isn't aware of this is carnal. It's because they're not living with eternity in mind. They're living about the now. For them, the life of the believer is about what they get out of God, not how God uses them for his glory. At best, God's going to chasten that individual. And so when chastening comes, immediately like, well, why did you? Possibly chastening comes because of the sins of omission. Sin is serious to God. You know why sin is serious? Because Christ died for it. At best, sins of omission will lead to chastening. It will happen. God will not spare the rod of chastening of his children. Whom he loves, he chastens. And if he chastens not, the scripture says, Hebrews 12, you're a bastard and not a son. At worst, it could be an indicator that that person's not even a child of grace at all. They can just go through life and maybe now they're just concerned with self-righteousness. Well, this is the things I'm not going to do. But they never are sensitive to the Holy Spirit. That may be very possible. The Spirit of God does not reside in that individual. Now, I'm closing. Come on, dear. Y'all never saw one of these in church before, did you? I'm not going to bullwhip her, I promise. I appreciate her. I want you to take that rope all the way down to that end, if you don't mind. Thank you, sweetie. Yeah, go ahead and take it on down there. Now, I did some mathematics last night, and by the way, I'm terrible at math. This is 47-foot rope. It's used for tug of war. Go ahead and stretch it on out, maybe. You might actually have to go out in there. I don't want it to be on a pulpit. Brother Jonathan, I'm gonna put your life on this rope. Ready? That dot right there. 70 years. That's 70 years right there. This is 1 millimeter. Takes 300.4 millimeters equal foot. There's 47 feet in this. So if I take 1 millimeter, take all the feet, this rope would be approximately, and here's, can y'all see his life right there? Y'all see that little dot? Y'all see it? No, y'all can't see it. It's insignificant. This is eternity. But actually, take the mathematics. You ready? Here's his life. That's that little dot right there, brother. You see that little dot? He's like, nah, really. But I'm going to say, yeah. There's a dot. That's his life, 70 years. This actually would only equate to 1,002,794 years. You know how long eternity is? It don't end. But here it is. There's his life. It's summed up. Do you know what's summed up in that 70 years? When he was born, when I was born, when I began to grow, when I began to form relationships, when I got married, when I had kids, I had my career, got my retirement, got my plans, and I got my death, all in that little dot. And here's what's so amazing to me. Austin, how in the world is it that you're so focused on this dot and not the rest of the rope? Because listen to me, every one of us in here are going somewhere for all eternity. And the most amazing thing to me is that God actually will allow me to cancel my eternal debt against Him in that little dot. Do you know what that tells me? Not only how bad my sin is, but boy, how good my Jesus is. How great my Jesus is. How great His death is. And so I'm challenging you today, stop living for that little dot and live for the rest of the rope unto the glory of God. Let's bow together for prayer. Father, thank you, God, for tearing me alive, tearing my heart up. Lord, I get asked to come and preach at a place like this that's so kind and inviting. And I realize at times, Lord, the old